be. 0141
951 1025. It's time to talk football. It's Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Good evening and welcome to Clyde One Super Scoreboard as the dust slowly begins to settle on the first Old Firm game of the season. James Tavernier says fans were right to boo at full time. So what does this break have in store for Michael Beale and the Rangers players? Callum McGregor says Celtic must use the win as a springboard for the rest of the season. And governing bodies and fans alike hit out at plans to change the rules around football supporters' buses in Scotland. I'm Gordon Duncan, and joining me tonight you have Mark Wilson and Gordon DL. Mark, it was quite the weekend. I don't think we're over it just yet.
Yeah, I was going to say, I don't think the dust is quite settled yet, Gordon. A lot of people have their opinions on what happened at the weekend. And the international break is a period that people can sit back and take stock of how they've started the season. That could be good for some people. It could be fatal for others. And Michael Beale has come under pressure in the last few days, and I just wonder how this storm will ride out for him. And of course, looking ahead, big game at the weekend for Scotland. It could be our first steps to qualification for Germany.
Yeah, looking forward to, obviously, Friday night, Scotland, but I don't think the talking is finished after the weekend, Gordon. His international break came at a good time for one or two teams. You look at Aberdeen, Barry Robson up there taking a bit of criticism. Hearts in a bad way just now, and obviously the big talking point, Michael Beale, has to get it right, but he's got 2 weeks now to get it sorted. I know he's lost one or two players in international duty, but he has to come back, hit the ground running very quickly.
Or is it a bad thing for these teams, Mark Wilson? You've got no choice but to suffer and stew on your disappointment, and you can't make up for it for a couple of weeks.
We always think it is a bad thing when you go into the international break and you've lost either a big game like the weekend, or you're on a poor run, or like Daz says, if you're Aberdeen or Hearts and crashed out of Europe, and then you start thinking or maybe overthinking things. You know, it's a lot easier when you can get back out on the pitch, on the training pitch and competitively, and put it behind you. But when you've got 2 weeks and players are away representing our country, you naturally give players a couple of days off. I think then you start questioning, is that the right thing? So you're never in quite good shape. And the opposite, if you're Brendan Rodgers in Celtic or you're Motherwell at the minute, it's a great time because you're justified in giving the players a few days off because you've started the season well. So I always found this international break quite an interesting time. Quite often I was off on holiday because I was never picked. So I loved it. And then for like Celtic, the likes of Celtic, those players who are resting up, who aren't away in international duty, can focus on the Champions League games that are coming just round the corner. What a big evening's coming up for Celtic, Rangers in the Europa League as well. So what a good football to come.
Come on then, 0141 951 1025, or it's Twitter at Clyde SSB. What is on your mind tonight? You don't get over a day like Sunday in just one night, so naturally. And by the way, the phone lines were outrageously busy last night, so maybe some of you still want to get something off your chest, you can do. Maybe it's the same thought as you had yesterday, or maybe a day down the line, particularly Rangers fans, maybe you have calmed down about things. What did I know? Maybe it's even worse as the week goes on. Pick up the phone, let us know all about your thoughts on the weekend's action and anything else that's out there, because we are starting slowly, albeit to look forward to international football later in the week. There's been a big story that might just do the impossible and unite every football fan in Scotland. Never thought I would see the day, but this story about changing the rules about supporters' buses and some of the things that you might have to do if you're a fan going on the bus, very controversial, and we could look at that later in the show if you fancy it, because like I say, they've done the impossible, I think, and united all Scottish football fans. So whatever it is, 0141 951 1025. Sore one for you, Mark Wilson. I've just seen the live stream on my screen here, and it must be a couple of seconds behind, and as you're talking, it really did look like you picked your nose there.
Oh, did it?
And I just
long as it wasn't mine. He had lost his arm.
Sorry, anyone that was eating their dinner or offended by that.
I'm sure you didn't actually, just what it looked like.
Maybe anyway. I did.
Your manners are
ridiculous. I forget the cameras are on
your
sometimes.
Your manners are ridiculous.
0141 951 1025, or Twitter at Clyde SSB. If this is the dust starting to settle, if that ever actually happens, Gordon DL, have you Have you changed your feelings on the weekend at all? Have they mellowed? Have you spotted something that you didn't notice at the time?
No, I think that the Rangers fans made that quite clear over Sunday and Monday, and I'm sure we'll get a few tonight, vent their anger against the players, the manager and everything that's going on. For Celtic, it was a fantastic day. They turned up there, minus a lot of key players. They had no supporters whatsoever. It wasn't a classic game of football. I said that on the show on Sunday, Gordon. But when these games come around, it's all about winning. It's all about that victory. Takes the pressure off of players, managers, supporters, get the bragging rights. But I think that the Rangers fans, there'll still be a lot out there, still a bit angry.
Those games, Gordon, it's all about big players turning up. You know, either whichever way you paint it, and tactics and, you know, the managers making certain decisions, it's big players on the pitch that determine the outcome. And Celtic have got big players who stand up to the occasion more often than not. And I'm talking about Kyogo in particular at the top end of the pitch, who in these games comes up trumps all the time. You know, there to put the ball in the back of the net. Cal McGregor just behind him. You know, more often than not in these big games will dictate them. And right through the spine of that Celtic team, as Brendan Rodgers said, there was real men there. You flip that over to Rangers at the weekend. The guys who have been carrying Rangers over this period since Michael Beale came in, I think Raskin has been impressive, and I think Cantwell has been a real standout. Tavernier comes in for such heavy criticism, but at least he pops up with goals, and you know, he gets Rangers out of the occasional hole sometimes. They just weren't there on Sunday at all, and it was quite telling. And especially when you're at home and when you've got 50,000 your own supporters behind you, it's a poor way to go out in this international break, and it leaves Rangers fans an awful lot of time to think and vent their anger through platforms that the players are, you know, it's easily accessible for the players to see. It can have a detrimental effect on you for the rest of the season.
Come on then, 01419511025. Tommy's going to kick things off. Take it away, Tommy.
I left a couple of days, I've got a 20 minutes, but I've got to go back to this referee. I'm a referee. And see if Mr. Robinson were called a foul in normal time, I'd have accepted that because it could have looked like a foul. But see, once he goes and looks at VAR, and you see Lagerfeld planting his right leg to protect the ball, and then bringing his left leg through, clipping desperately, clipped his own calf and get down. Didn't he claim for a foul or nothing? So I don't know what Mr. Robinson's seen.
So how would you have been? How would you have been okay if that decision had been given in real time? Why would you have been okay with it then if you didn't think it was
because
a foul?
It's an honest mistake. It looked like a foul when you see it, it appeared to have been a foul. Once you see it on VAR, you know it's not.
Well, to be fair, what I thought Tommy was going to say was, I think it is a foul, but I don't think it's a clear and obvious error, and that's why I don't think VAR should have got involved. Because that, to me, at least seems like a legitimate.
It's very funny because the referee seen it the different way from Tommy. He thought it wasn't a foul, and then when he went to VAR, he thought it was a foul and called it off. So, listen, this is one that's splitting so many opinions, Gordon. I said on Sunday when I watched it in real time that I thought it was a perfectly good goal. I then changed my mind when I seen a few replays. Everybody I've spoken to since, everybody I've heard, I was listening to a show last night, the difference in opinions is incredible.
What have you settled on?
I think that it is a foul.
Is it a clear and obvious error for VAR to get involved?
I was going to say, I don't know if VAR should have got involved in it. I think that the referee had a good position. Obviously he let it go. He let the goal stand. But you've got to slow it down. You've got to look at it so many times. Now, the only thing I will say is the referee got the same opportunity to go over the screen and he changed his mind. So it shows you how tight the decision was. But even getting back to that, and I know the argument, well, it'd have been a great start from Rangers. Certainly would have been bouncing and they'd have been on the front foot. I totally take that on board. Whether you think that was a foul or not a foul, you were robbed or not robbed, I still look at the overall performance and some of the things that are going on with the players, the new signings that come in. You look at that Celtic back four that finished, and we're not being disrespectful at all, because if everybody fit, that back four's never playing together. right? Rangers have brought in millions of pounds of centre forwards and players. You know, you look at Dessers, Lammers, Danilo, you know, what's that? They got to 10 million or something. Now, you must see an opportunity at home with 50,000 behind you to go and at least threaten them to score a goal. Lammers, I think, should have scored. But apart from that...
To be fair, Tommy, I don't think you'll acknowledge some of that as well, won't you?
I agree with everything Gordon said. I still disagree with what his opinion, whether it was a foul or not, because Mr. Robinson never gave a foul. And as you said, it's not clear and obvious. So why would somebody tell him to go and look at the TV? The women's game is miles ahead of us, because in the Women's World Cup, the ref came out and explained why they've given the decision or not given the decision. So why can't we have the same thing?
Yeah, I don't think, for me, from what I saw anyway, or certainly at the start of the tournament, they still didn't give me the full sort of explanation that I would like. It was a step in the right direction, but, you know, I take your point.
Going to get any nuts and bolts, but no.
Mark, what was you, because by the way, although I just asked Gordon the question because it's important, was it clear and obvious? Forget Celtic and Rangers for a minute. Very difficult. This has always been one of the biggest problems with VAR, because you might say it's not clear and obvious, but clearly Alan Muir thought it was Alan Muir, sorry, wasn't it?
VAR. Not sure.
Or maybe I've mixed that up. But anyway, whoever it was, for some reason the name's gone out of my head, obviously thought it was. And again, you know, because we use the phrase of clear and obvious as if it's some sort of factual statement when it's not.
I was going to say, Gordon, I wish we would just drop that, clear and obvious.
And this is, but that's an IFAB VAR thing, isn't it?
Because it puts everybody in quite an awkward situation, particularly the referee. VAR has been put into your game to help the right decision, the right outcome come out. The referees will miss things in games. It's only natural. The game's a million miles an hour. He's not going to pick up everything. So if there is a foul there, which I believe there was, I'm the same as Daz, and maybe Tommy online, that in real time I didn't think it was a foul. You slow it down. You cannot deny that Lager Bielka is going to kick the ball. Dessers plants his foot and then nicks the ball. Now, if Dessers had nicked the ball first, just nicked it away, I think he's every right.
That was Bobby Madden's explanation. I don't know if you saw that. He took to Instagram in a series of sort of stories. He spoke about Lager Bielka being in control. He then said that because Dessers hasn't played the ball, and he puts his foot between the defender and the ball, it's a foul anywhere in the pitch. This is the words of Bobby Madden. Had the attacker played the ball before the contact, fine, but he was never in control or possession, so he thinks it's a foul. However, as people also then pointed out on the other side, Dermot Gallagher pops up in Sky and says, can't believe VAR even got involved. Good goal, carry on, as you were.
Well, look, right away, we were watching the replays, Gordon, and actually we were mid-sentence. We were actually, at the time, I think I was picking on Lager Bielka for dallying on the ball when we caught a glimpse of the replay, and I said right away, that's a foul. You know, so it was just instant. It was obvious to me that was a foul. But the clear and obvious thing, it's either a foul or it's not. Yeah. And a VAR, if somebody's sitting watching a screen and can help their mate out, it's on the pitch. Check every, that's
and,
what they're there
and
for.
And they're going to check every goal as well for you know, the attacking phase of play, that sort of thing.
We were in the studio. I'm different from Mark Madden, who's sitting beside me here. When I seen it in real time, I thought it was a perfectly good goal, Gordon. I've got to say, I thought that the centre-half got caught. The Dessers obviously picks his pocket, plays a good ball, roof, end of story, goal. But when it slowed down, I had to watch it and watch it and watch it. And I can hear all the arguments. I've heard it for 2 days now. Even when I'm out and about, people will still talk about it in different opinions.
Do people stop you and talk about
it? Yeah, even today, I'm putting for a birdie and a boy shouting in the background. I'm disgusted with
them. See, you've come straight through the course.
Disgusted with them. But I've got to, I can see both ends, but it's all about opinion. But Don Robertson got flagged up with VAR, he went over, he had a lot of time to look at it, and he decided, it's a free kick. And at the end of the day, as much as we're debating it, there's only one opinion at that time that mattered.
Absolutely. Let's bring in Mark. Thank Tommy for his calls. Bring in Mark and Fife. How's it going, Mark?
Hiya. I'm phoning up just get an opinion of the panel. I watched the highlights back Sunday night to the Old Firm. The one where Kyogo was cleaned through, and I think it's Goldson clears it off the line. I've seen Jack Butland clearly pushes Kyogo to the point where he goes flying. The ball was still in play, So technically, should VAR know have maybe looked at that?
It's a good question. By the way, it's not one we know. I didn't notice at the time.
I didn't notice at the time.
Have you not seen it at all?
No.
It was late Sunday night. I noticed it, and I put it on a Facebook group, and everybody's saying that should have been a penalty. Surely VAR.
Sunday night, I went to bed.
Come on, this is the live stream.
You were well on.
This is the live stream. You're more than welcome. Why don't you get up out your chair, come round, and I'll show you. Don't mind that.
Yeah, okay. I've got my shorts on.
Get a shot of his legs here.
You can answer, Mark, because you've seen it.
I did see it. So Kyogo obviously runs through and goal. He beats Butland. Goals, incredible goal line clearance. But as Kyogo's kind of stumbling, Butland gets up and pushes Kyogo two-handed in the six-yard box. Now, nobody... I'll just fill time to hear back. There he is. Nobody's seen it at the time. I certainly didn't see it at the time, but it's only social media. I've got to say, you can't just push a player like that when the ball is actively in play in the box. So it's a fair argument that if the referee saw that...
You don't seem as convinced.
Listen, I can see the argument. I didn't notice
that. You always say that. Just tell me what you think.
What is this with you? Stop sitting on the fence. You're not going to get slaughtered either way. Your opinion.
I'm not sitting on the fence. I think I'm fair-minded. Yeah, he could have been lucky there. He shouldn't be lifting his hands.
He could have been lucky.
He's a bit lucky, I've got to say.
We're getting the opinion now.
He shouldn't lift his hands. Look, if the ball had went out of play and it was a case of
the ball's still in play. Put
some under a little bit of pressure. I've got to say, great spot by you guys. I didn't see that.
You should have done your homework before you came on the show.
Listen, you've watched one clip of Bobby Madden, you think you're a ref.
That's the beauty of social media, because let's be honest, nobody notices that at the time, because everybody's looking at Conor Goldson's block and you're waiting to see if the ball ends up in the back of the net. Nobody notices that one at the time, I don't suppose. I mean, Mark, is it? I think it's a bit easier to swallow when you've won the game. I'm sure you were delighted overall.
Drew, I got a beat. We wouldn't have made Mary a point of that, but I was thinking more if it was Joe Hart and it was a Rangers player, it would have been kind of, they would have been shouting for a penalty.
I dare say, listen, there's no hiding place in social media, because I thought that's a good spot. I didn't hear anyone talk about that at all after.
Great spot.
It's not been mentioned anywhere, really. So.
There you go. That's what we're here for.
Yeah. The big thing about that is, Gordon's right. Daz is right. If that ball's out of play and there's a push, then these things happen. The ball's in play, actively in play. Kyogo could have came active again if that ball had rebounded back to him off someone, but he's been pushed to the ground.
Well, you take it in the context. If Abada's down the right wing and Kyogo's in the middle and Butland runs out and just... He's in trouble, isn't he?
The thing about that clip is that people keep circulating on social media. You can't see where the ball is, but it's very much there. I mean, it's only just been sliced up in the air. Anyway, thank you very much, though, to Mark, 01419511025. That was a quick opening to the show. We'll be back with more of your calls next.
You are the voice of Scottish football. Call 01419511025. Clyde One, Super Scoreboard.
Gordon Deal and Mark Wilson are here at 01419511025. It's Twitter at Clyde SSB. And if these phone lines are anything to go by, people are not over Sunday's game yet. And nor should you be, because it's always good fun to have a bit of conversation as the week progresses. A couple on refereeing decisions early on. If you are the type who likes to talk about the actual other side of the game, that would be lovely. I think it's always a bit more interesting to look at some of the other talking points as well. So come on down. What about Joe, I think, who's next through? Joe's in Cambuslang. How's it going, Joe?
Hi, good evening, guys.
Are you well? What's been the process like as a Rangers fan? Are you calming down? Are you angrier than where you were, or what?
I wouldn't say angry. I mean, very disappointed. I mean, I actually did something on Sunday that I never normally do. I mean, I've had a season ticket at Ibrox for over 30 years. And myself and my son actually left the game at 78 minutes. I've never, ever done that, and I was actually ashamed of myself for doing it. But the way we were playing, and from the very, very beginning, it became obvious. I mean, even in the first 10, 15 minutes, it became obvious that we were going to get nothing for the game. I just think the team, looking at them, don't know what they're doing. I just don't think we've got anybody there that's who's going to win us a game. I mean, I know Ryan Kent was in and out, but Ryan Kent still had that bit of magic that he could do every now and again. I just don't think there's anybody in that team that's got it. When Michael Beale came in, I'll be honest, I wasn't a huge fan of Michael Beale. But again, he's a Rangers manager, I'll back him. I'm going to make a point which I know is going to be unpopular with a lot of Rangers fans. I've actually had arguments with my uncle about this.
Well, I'm excited about this. Where's this going?
I think the man that should get the job is Derek McInnes. I think Derek McInnes has proved time and time again. He rebuilt that Aberdeen team every summer because they were stripped. He rebuilt the team every summer. He's doing what he can at Kilmarnock with probably one of the lowest budgets in the Premier League. I think with a better quality of player, more money, I think Derek McInnes is a man that, in, for me, should get the job.
Right, let me stop you in your tracks just slightly, because I'm sure you know there isn't a job to get right now. So that's what I was going to ask. Are we genuinely at that stage for you, Joe, despite, you know, all the obvious counter-arguments you would hear about, four league games into the season, Michael Beale's just brought all these players in, even although you don't think they're any good. Are we seriously at that stage?
If you look at what he's brought in, Gordon, I mean, if you look at, take Sam Lammers, for instance, right? I made a point today of looking at his stats. He scored one goal and one assist for Sampdoria, one goal and one assist for Empoli. Eintracht Frankfurt, he scored one goal. Atalanta, he scored two goals. Cyril Dessers, stats aren't any better either. I mean, we went after these players. We've paid decent money for us just now because, I mean, when you're a Rangers fan, you also need to be a chartered accountant because of what's been going on there for the last 10 to 12 years. So, also, I mean, you look at it, Danilo. I mean, we've spent, if you believe, I mean, I know Michael Beale came out and said the figures quoted are way off the mark, but if you believe the press, we paid $6 million for Danilo and the guy sits on the bench. I mean, he's the most expensive player we've bought since we spent the $7 million in Ryan Kent, and the guy sits on the bench. I mean, you've made a point at the weekend saying you think that's Dessers up to speed and at full fitness. Well, if that's Dessers up to speed and full fitness, God help us. God help us. I mean, I just don't think we're in for another season of mediocrity, in my opinion.
Where
another
are we? Okay.
Mediocrity.
Where are we actually then for you to, where we get calls on to say who the next Rangers manager should be, and we can get to that actual suggestion in a minute.
Yeah.
But is that valid? Is that appropriate just now? Or?
I think a lot of comments he's making are spot on the money. I think most Rangers fans are questioning the signings. It's very hard to argue with. You know, Lammers, Dessers, Danilo, Sima, they've offered nothing for me, Gordon. I've not seen anything in them at all. So that's a bit disappointing. But I'm not in the camp just now of saying four games in. I know the PSV one was a very, very difficult night to take for most Rangers supporters. But I'm not in the camp of saying Michael Beale must go. I think Michael Beale's got to prove to the Rangers supporters that he's good enough and big enough to do the job. Now, he's not been in management a long, long time. He had a sort of a quick spell at QPR. He's come up here into... It's a massive job going from QPR to Rangers. There's no doubt about that. And it's all about results. It's all about winning. Or you come under this criticism that he's come under. I say the weekend, I've heard since Michael Beale stepped into Scottish football, how great a coach he is. I've listened to Andy Halliday, who worked under him, and I take Andy's, you know, opinion on board, and I don't disagree with it. But that sort of a reputation of being such a great coach, I'm like most Rangers supporters that go every week to Ibrox or every second week. I'm not seeing the patterns of what he's doing. He might be a great coach on the training ground, but right now I don't think the players are taking that onto the pitch. I look at them at the weekend, I have no idea what they're trying to achieve. It was long ball after long ball early doors. It was the same at Kilmarnock, but I would state right now, I don't think it is a time for a sack Michael Beale.
Social media has changed everything, obviously, Mark, but particularly these types of discussions, because naturally people are going to lash out on there after any defeat. Doesn't matter if it's the first game of the season or the 50th, if it doesn't go their way, you will see somebody saying, you know, manager out, whatever team it is. You know, Joe's saying that should be the case. I don't know if you saw that, you know, today, for instance, Twitter rumour, if that's all it is, talks about Kevin Muscat being considered by Rangers as to be their next manager. Rangers this afternoon, presumably, because it starts appearing in a few places on social media from people that are quite close to the club. So, you know, sources at Rangers say that there's no truth in this. So on one hand, well, yeah, that you might say that's harmless, because if Rangers think there's misinformation out there, they're just going to correct it. But to me, that still seems weird that there's like a legitimate conversation going on around that. That makes sense.
Yeah, yeah, certainly. I mean, the current landscape of football, the way it is just now, the way social media has changed the game, really, and changed the way owners think and look internally at their own club. Michael Beale is in a whole load of trouble at this
by
minute.
The way, it's not just social media. I'm talking about the people that were at the game.
Yeah, yeah.
Joe left, but those who stayed made
them. Well, Joe left. The pictures that we saw after the game, the supporters, you know, making their feelings known to the players, that's beamed everywhere. It does not look good. And Michael Beale coming out after that, you know, it's very difficult for managers to come out and justify that in a press conference. So I've got every sympathy with that, because there's only so much you can say. You're never going to make anybody happy with that, and everybody's concentrating every word you say. But the whole thing about it's just four games, it isn't just four games. And I need to keep going back to that. And that's from Rangers fans. That's glaringly obvious to Rangers fans. It's not just this game against Celtic, or the opening day against Kilmarnock, or struggling through against Morton, or humiliation against PSV. It's what came before, the big games against Celtic, you know, and the other league games that they did win last season. People were saying, well, wasn't it really entertaining to watch? But when Beale gets his own players, I'm sure there'll be something we see. Now, you add it all together, it's an uncomfortable position that he finds himself in at the minute. And whether you like it or not, chairman, owners, chief execs, concentrate in what's said in social media. They gauge what the fans
slightly do, though. I mean, surely the reaction at full time in the stadium will literally have been heard louder than anything else.
Yeah,
it?
I slightly disagree with Mark. I know where Mark's coming from, and I know he can back the argument. Well, Michael Beale's been in the building for 10, 11 months, whatever it may be. But this was his summer. He lost a lot of good players, a lot of players that were successful at Rangers. Good players, international players as well. Now, he's been given the backing from the board to bring in, what, 9 players? And we're 4 games in. Now, I still think that 4 games in is a better... You look at Hibs, I've already got rid of a manager. Aberdeen are in a sticky wicket just now. I've read that Barry Robson's coming under a bit of pressure. The two lads at Hearts coming under a bit of pressure. All of a sudden, if clubs are going through a little bit of a bad time, or the results are not there, the new signings are not hitting the ground running, after 4 games, man, I'll guarantee you by next season, how many managers in the Premier League do you think will lose their job? Probably 4 or 5.
Let's bring in John, who is in Cumbernauld. John, what's your take on things at the moment?
I've been a Rangers fan most of my life, been a season ticket holder since I was 10. I've always backed the manager and backed the team. It takes a lot for me to say it's time for Michael Beale to go. It's really, really unbelievable what's happening on the pitches. Nobody else to blame but himself. He made the points that these are my players. I've looked them in the eye. I've talked to them, blah, 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 blah. And not one of them has performed decently well, apart from Butland. And he's got nowhere to go but himself.
What is it about this time then that's so much worse for you, John? If you're saying you always back managers and stuff like that, what's worse about this time?
I just don't see any plan. I don't see any style of play. I don't see any invention with the team. It's always a make-do attitude with Rangers. There's a few people that we always rely on. People at Tavernier, people at Goldson, we've relied on these players for so long that we're stuck now, and we're in danger of becoming irrelevant. And it could end up like Germany, and only one team winning everything, and maybe once in a wee while somebody else will win something.
Well, it's getting like that. You only have to look at the record books to see that is actually what's happened over the last, I don't know how many years, what, 10, 12 years. And, of course, Rangers had their difficulties off the pitch at that time. But now that they've got things in line behind the scenes, they need to be performing and putting up a better fight to Celtic on the pitch. And on the face of it, I was with everybody else when Michael Beale came in. Heard all the rumours, and Daz touched on Andy, and you heard other players saying he was a terrific coach. I think the Rangers fans got real optimism that we're going to see something special, and he's playing. That's maybe what's hindering them or putting them in this position just now, that's just never materialised. With that old squad that have now went their different ways, or with this new squad. And fans concentrate so much on style. Winning's not enough nowadays. If you win ugly 1-0 every week, fans will go away unhappy, or they'll phone this show. It's boring to watch. We've seen it before. So you need to win, and win with a bit of style at clubs like Rangers. And Michael Beale started the season doing neither. And that's why John and Joe before him are on saying it's not the guy that they want to see in charge anymore.
I mean, John, everyone seems to be talking about what they want to happen. Genuinely, is change imminent, or is this just something that will sort of disappear a bit over the international break?
I think Walter Smith said it himself. You're only ever 3 games of getting fired at Rangers. I do think he'll keep his job. I think they'll probably wait to after the international break and give him another wee while. But by then, the horse is already bolted. If he loses the next 2 games after the international break, that's it, finished. You've got to think what he's already done. He's lost. He's won 1 game in Europe. He's won 50% of the league campaign. I don't know what else he needs to do for the board to go, right, we need a shift here, because there's always a decision to stick a twist, and it always seems that the board takes a, right, we'll stick and see if it gets better and hope it gets better, rather than actively doing something to make it better.
But the big problem that is, one, it sort of puts the spotlight on who brought Michael Beale in, who's backed him, because you've given them 9 players and decent money. They've spent decent money in the summer to bring in these 9 players, and to just go and say, "No, we're going to rip that up. We're going to leave that to another manager who'll come in with his own ideas." Where I do agree with the caller is he cannot afford to lose the next 2 games. In fact, I don't even think he can afford to lose the next one. But I've never been convinced with Michael Beale, right? I think Rangers is a massive, massive job. And I don't know if Michael Beale came QPR to Rangers too quickly for me. Now, I keep going back to great coach. But as a manager, you need more than being a great coach. You need leadership, you need strength, you need different sort of qualities in that dressing room that we don't see, and how you handle players in different one-to-one situations. I don't know what like Michael Beale is at that. So I think that Michael Beale has got a massive job in his hand, but 4 games in, and I know the European campaign last week was very disappointing, I wouldn't be sitting here crying to get him sacked. Mm. I think he's got to start winning games very quickly, and I think Mark makes a great point. Rangers fans don't like and are not impressed with style of football. He needs to do something quickly.
Thomas in Barrhead is coming up next.
Clyde One. Make me a winner.
Yeah, it was the second day of our big cash game, Make Me a Winner. And the person we called answered with a hello, as you sometimes would, but not Make Me a Winner. We're just going to answer every call for the rest of their lives with Make Me a Winner. That means it's a rollover, so we could make you the winner of £54,000 tomorrow when we make another call. But you need to be in the draw, so text YES to 61025. Texts are £2 plus your standard network rate. You can enter on our website. Online entries cost £2, or call 0330 880 4523, and the calls are charged at a standard rate. It's over 18s only, and all the rules for this network competition are online. So if you get the call from us after 3 p.m. tomorrow, Wednesday the 5th, answer within 5 rings and say Make Me a Winner straight away. Don't say anything else, just say Make Me a Winner to win that £54,000. So the entries since Cath won on Monday have rolled over, and remember, it's text YES to 61025.
The team with the biggest support in Glasgow and the West. This is Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Mark Wilson and Gordon DL are here at 0141 951 1025. You know, before the break we were talking about, you know, like reaction on social media and Michael, in relation to Michael Beale's position and so on. And I don't really have time to check all the social media platforms during the show. It's quite busy keeping an eye on YouTube. But during the break, wee minute to myself, I'll have a wee flick through Instagram, see what's happening on there, and talk about the pitfalls of social media. So what do you make of this? Kamal Roof has decided to upload a series of pictures of his goal from the weekend.
Really?
And needless to say, it's just not gone down that well with the, with his own fan base.
He's done that by himself.
Oh yeah, presumably. If you click through the comments, what up you are, delete this, get a grip, get this done, the goal got chopped off and we lost. Are you really that engage your brain, delete this mate, etc, etc, etc.
That'd be something you would do. If Instagram was about in your playing days and you get beat 5-1 or something, you would put up your goal.
I scored enough legit goals. I wouldn't need to put
an odd
ones
post. You surely need to read the room.
Is that a judgment error?
Without doubt.
Probably. He doesn't think so. He'll probably get a lot of Rangers fans on there saying, well done.
Apparently not.
Well done for what?
Saying that he believes it was a goal, like most Rangers supporters. Nothing up with that bit of opinion.
He's sitting on the fence mood tonight.
Anyway, Thomas is on the line. Advised. Thomas, what's on your mind tonight?
Evening, gentlemen. It's a few things. I was at the game on Sunday, and before I come to my point about Rangers, I would have to say that in 60 years of following Rangers, that was the worst Old Firm game I've seen. Normally, and I mean on both sides, normally you'll have one side will play the other off the park, whether, you know, when we were getting beat 4 or 5-0, Celtic were outstanding and we couldn't live with them. And, you know, going back to your 9-in-a-row days, you know, poor Tommy Burns, he was losing all the games against us, losing the league. But, you know, it was a first-class Rangers team. Probably the worst Celtic and Rangers game I've seen, with both teams playing so badly. However, to my own point, when Angie came in at Celtic, and Brendan Rodgers as well, Angie had a bad couple of results, but everybody was saying he has a style, he's playing to a particular pattern, he needs to bring that together. Brendan Rodgers has come in and he's changed Angie's style and he's trying to bring in his own style. But the problem is at Rangers, none of the supporters and none of the Rangers supporters I know what the Michael Beale's style or formation is. For example, and I mean, it's a genuine question. Can the panel say, who is our number 9? Do we have one? Because the front three just don't appear to have a main focus. We don't seem to have a number 9. Todd Cantwell, towards the end of last season, he was a standout. This season, we don't actually quite know what role he's got. Is he breaking from deep, a holding midfielder? To me, he should be playing just off the number 9. But again, it brings me to my original point. There is no number 9. There's absolutely no formation in that team at all. And I don't think the players themselves know what their job is, because they get the ball and then it's like, I mean, you're 1-0 down, 5 minutes into injury time, and I counted 6 passes in our own half going along that back four, and you're 1-0 down because they basically did not know what to do.
Take it away. Who wants to answer that point?
Well, look, I said, 10 minutes ago that the reputation of Michael Beale, and it's easy on a training ground. You've got to put that onto the pitch match days so that people can recognise it. And that's the one fault I've looked at Michael Beale and thought, I've not seen that. You know, I've heard the reputation, I've heard everything, and I'm not doubting it, you know, because I've heard it for good people, I've heard it for guys that have worked under him. But I've never seen the structure, I've never seen the plan that's been put onto the pitch. I went along to the pre-season game, watched him, and I come away with the same opinion, thinking, didn't really know what he was trying to do there. Taking into consideration pre-season, plenty of subs, it's all about fitness, I take that on board. But since Michael Beale's come into the building, I've never really seen this partner play how he's trying to play.
How much of it do you think, Mark, is by instruction, and how much do you think is, you know, players then not doing it, not taking the initiative on the pitch? Andy's take the other night, and I just mentioned it because he's worked with him before. Andy's take, Andy Halliday, was that actually Rangers front three were engaging a bit, But then there was this big massive gap behind it, and that's what allows Callum McGregor to get all that space. So actually, yeah, Scales and Lager Bielka didn't have that much time, but as soon as it went to Callum McGregor, he's the one.
Yeah.
That then, so like the logic might follow that surely that wasn't deliberate. Surely that's not by design.
Well, you've got a problem either way, because if it is by design, then it's clearly the wrong tactics. You don't want to give Celtic that amount of time.
Well, especially him though, especially Callum McGregor, because you know what he's capable of.
If he's told his players to do the opposite and they've not done it, then it's a serious problem, because your players aren't taking on instructions. Either they're not good enough, or they don't believe in the instructions that you're telling them, and they're going on to the pitch with their own ideas. Either way, doesn't work. So you need to find a solution, find it quickly for that. To answer Thomas's question, who is the number nine? It's a good question. Don't really know. Das said they went along in pre-season. At that time, pre-season, were they not playing two up front? And they were playing...
Seema played off on the left-hand side. Yeah. Listen, I'm excusing pre-season. It's more
but
like...
But then what I was going to say is we saw them against Kilmarnock, and Seema partnered Dessers for a bit. Then Danilo comes into it. Then all of a sudden there was a switch. It was a front three. There was Dessers up front. Matondo was off one side. We've seen Cantwell play off a side in the front three as well in the European game, I'm sure. Then he drops deep, like Thomas said. So much chopping and changing. It leads you to think that maybe even Michael Beale doesn't know, what his best formation, or two, who's the best personnel to fill that.
I think the biggest problem right now, and as I say, listen, everybody's jumping on the bandwagon here, and rightly so, to criticise because of the performances and everything. He's brought in players. He's changed all these front players. I heard Andy Halliday making a great point last night. Dessers, Lammers and Seema. If you had Morelos, Sakala and Kent, who would you play just now? And that's where you put yourself under pressure as a manager, because when you bring in new players, you want them to be, I know it's sometimes difficult, but you want them to be better than your previous players. You don't want fans to be phoning up here three games in, and we heard it last week. Oh, I would take Morelos back in a minute. The Rangers fans at times were desperate to get Morelos out the building. Now they'll take him back in a minute.
How confident are you, or where are your confidence levels, Thomas, that Michael Beale turns this round quickly?
I can't see it, if I'm honest. My problem is, I had a discussion with my son about whether we get rid of Michael Beale or whether we don't. And I think one of the problems, and it's why I think you'll get some time, you'll get the international break and a bit more. We've spent, as I said, apparently, I don't know if this is true, but apparently we've spent more this summer than we have since 2001. And I don't know how much money's left in the pot to both pay Michael Beale and his staff off, because I imagine he's still got quite a bit left in his contract to go, and then go and seek to pay compensation to take another guy on board. The problem I have with Rangers and their choice of managers, see, when you go right back to Mark Warburton, Rangers were a job in progress, and I've always felt that we needed a tried and tested manager just to put the brakes on, to build a structure, somebody that's been over the course. But we seem to come in with projects. Mark Warburton, who'd heard of him? Pedro Caixinha, even Stevie Gerrard was taken for a youth team into Rangers with no experience. After that, we had Gio again. Okay, he had a bit of experience. I just wish they would go for a tried and tested manager that could just get that team started and kicking again. And we've not done that basically since Ali McCoist.
Well, I don't know what's going to happen in the next couple of weeks, but certainly it's a lively old discussion that's still going on Tuesday evening. And it already, what a quick opening to the show that was. It's time for this.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
You two don't look focused for Beat the Pundit tonight.
No,
I'm up for it.
I'm okay.
This guy just giving off a nervous energy.
Everybody phoning in tonight will be wanting to play this guy. This guy's having a nightmare.
Bring it on. Bring it on.
01419511025. If you want to get in touch and play Beat the Pundit, please do, but you need to call before 7.
Tackle the headlines. 01419511025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Mark Wilson and Gordon DL are here. It's 01419511025. It's Twitter at Clyde SSB. So please do get in touch. We have been still poring over the details from Sunday's game at Ibrox, so keep them coming if you want. If you want to move on altogether, you can do that as well. But first of all, before we go any further, let's play this.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
Right, it is Beat the Pundit time. I must admit, so busy with everything that's been said on the show, I can't even remember who played last night. I think it was Hugh.
I missed it last night. Did they win? Unfortunately.
Genuinely can't even remember. Just shows you. Yeah, he did. 3-2, actually.
3-2 to the Keevans.
He knows his stuff, Shug.
Well, sometimes. Sometimes he does. Let's find out who's playing tonight. It is Connor in Coatbridge. How's it going, Connor?
All right, mate. How's it doing?
Not bad at all. Have you ever played before?
Nah, mate. Never played.
Never. Who do the audience think is easier out of these two?
Oh, it's got to be DL.
Yeah.
Aye, okay, Connor.
Would you disagree with that?
And this season's form, he's won. Has he won again? You won again?
I've won one, yeah, but they've all been high scoring defeats, so.
Well, you've lost a couple this season as well.
Okay, but I've got a better record than him.
Listen, it's Connor's opinion.
You know something?
It's Connor's opinion.
That's what he's. High scoring defeats. A defeat's a defeat. Anyway, a ball is a ball.
Connor thinks you're a muppet.
It is Mark Wilson. Tails, it's Gordon DL. And it is Tails, it's you. Mr. Turquoise.
The Muppets.
Is that what we're calling that? Go. Turquoise.
A t-shirt.
Yeah.
It's lovely.
That's blue.
It's not bad, actually.
No, it's a turquoise.
Yeah.
So By the way, Connor sounds very nervous.
It's disturbing sitting here. Look, people can't see, they might have seen it, but just glancing and seeing his legs.
Bare legs, things you never want to see.
They're really skinny for a guy.
Speed,
heavy, heavier.
Speed. When you'll see me getting out of this studio at 5 to 8.
Sturdy. Like a sturdy built, you know, stocky. We'll say he's got skinny legs.
Speaking of which,
they're horrible. Yeah,
you're going to hate this, but it has struck me tonight. I think you've lost a lot of weight.
Aye.
Have you? I just think, is everything okay? The audience need to know.
Hold on. That'd be me.
No, you've not. But I think he has. I think he genuinely
has. I've put muscle on.
I know. I think that's the sore thing for you. You're fasting and he has lost
weight. No, but I'm muscle.
I'm just eating what I want. I mean, McDonald's every day.
I looked at him in the water cooler earlier and thought, he's fading away, that boy.
Kidding,
do you know
man,
what I think it is? No. I think it's because he's playing in the Masters on Saturday and he's trying to shift a bit of timber.
I might have something to do with it. I did see me in this last year.
Drinking all the water. Salad after salad.
I was pretty tight, so hopefully it'll be all
right. Anyway, let's give Mark Wilson, Gordon DL, some greatest hits radio to listen to. The clock is ready. Connor, 30 seconds, answer as many as you can and pass if you don't know the answer, okay?
Yep, sounds good.
Right, your time starts now. What nationality is new Celtic signing Luis Palma?
Honduras.
Who is the current caretaker manager of Hibs?
Pass.
At what stadium do Montrose play their home games?
Pass.
True or false, Auchan Lake Talbot won 12-0 at the weekend?
True.
Who is the only member of the current Scotland squad that plays in Italy?
Hendry.
Name two teams in the SPFL that begins with S.
Pass.
Alan Hutton won the English League Cup with which side?
Birmingham.
Okay, let's bring Gordon DL back. Can you hear us?
I can.
SOS.
Oh, brilliant, wasn't it?
So you might SOS, need, but
I love it.
You
oh,
might
good?
Need this depending on how bad this was for you.
Okay, let's go.
30 seconds starts now.
Hurry up.
Or does it? Come on. What nationality is new Celtic signing Luis Palma?
French.
Who's the current caretaker manager of Hibs?
Grey.
At what stadium do Montrose play their home games?
Lynch Park.
True or false, Auchan Lake Talbot won 12-0 at the weekend?
True.
Who's the only member of the current Scotland squad that plays in Italy?
Ferguson.
Name two teams in the SPFL that begin with the letter S.
Stirling Albion. Oh, name two. Sunra. Sorry.
Actually, you're not getting the second.
No, I'm getting that.
No chance. You can't get that.
I thought you said one of the two.
But there's more than two though. So one of the two wouldn't.
Oh right, okay. But you've got to give me that.
Anyway, no way.
See if I get beat with that.
Connor, what do you think?
Shocking.
Oh, you have made my night, little Connor. Connor, just stay on the line for the next 10 minutes.
Were you nervous, Connor?
Aye. Connor.
Was it Connor? I couldn't hear him.
Connor Wilson, he's a legend.
Thanks, Connor. Well said, Connor.
Get a pair of fresh ones on, Connor, quickly.
I tell you what.
Up the stairs.
Connor, he's awfully chirpy for a guy that thought Louis Palma was French.
Where is he from?
I have to say.
Sweden.
Honduras.
They asked Emilio Izaguirre all about him.
I bet you Connor didn't get that.
He did.
Of course he did.
You're up against it a bit.
No, Connor's white. Connor's white.
David Gray is the caretaker.
Connor's no chance. He doesn't even know what Hibs are.
1-1. Montrose play their home games at Lynx.
2-1, Connor. Anyway,
that's a good shout. I don't know if I would have got that.
Would you not?
I would have just
never
panicked.
Go there with Breakin.
I did in pre-season. Aye.
2-1, Connor. How are you feeling now, son?
Yeah, bye.
A cup of tea and a biscuit. Get yourself into bed.
Auchin like Talbot did win 12-0 at the weekend.
Yeah.
But Connor got it as well.
That's okay.
Can you tell me who they beat? I'd love this.
It was in the Scottish Cup,
remember? So was
Vale of Leaven?
No, it was Wigtown and Bladnock.
They're
a force. Yeah. Where
Clyde
from?
Bank won 10-0
up north.
No, they didn't.
10-1.
10-1.
Sorry,
Four bankies. William went one up.
Oh, did they?
And then conceded 10.
And then sat deep.
Tried to protect the lead.
Right, keep going, because I want Connor away. I want him.
Lewis Ferguson's the only member of the squad who plays in Italy.
Come on, Connor.
Connor was kind of. He said Jack Hendry, who used to play there.
Keep going.
I'm not giving you this. Two teams in the SPFL with St Mirren, St Johnston, Stirling Albion, Stenny, Stranraer, Spartans. Although, is it not this Spartans?
What did Connor say?
Age passed. He was gone by that stage. He was really gone.
Connor, you still want to play me now? Yeah? You're awful quiet, Connor. You were chirpy early on. You're awful quiet.
The irony is, Connor actually got more questions than you. Connor had time as many to
come back.
Keep as many as you want.
Alan Hutton won the English League Cup with, it was Spurs.
He never even get that.
He said Birmingham. Oh, gone by that point. Connor, don't listen to these two. I'm delighted you took part. Hard lines.
Yeah,
Connor.
Go on the chase next week, Connor. Let's see what you've got there, mate. I'm sure Bradley's delighted to see people
right,
like you come.
You've taken it too far. Thank you, Connor.
Connor's devastated. Keep a chin up, mate. I liked you.
What would your nickname be on the chase, do you think?
The bugle.
All right.
The big bugle.
Lost half a pun. He's out there getting people stuck.
I don't know, that just came to me instantly. That was a reaction.
I think they would just call me the Dazzler.
It's a bit predictable.
No, you think about it, because this is a part of this show I love. People at Connor, come on, I'd rather play DL. Bang, done. Off ski.
Up the road,
Connor.
Poor Connor.
Tail between the legs. Family disown them. No chance.
Good to see you're taking it well. 0141 951 1025.
Imagine I'm on the chase. Imagine if he won. If he beat the chaser.
Oh yeah.
Mark, I don't think we need to worry about that.
I'm good at a chase, by somehow. The way.
Do you know you can apply for that?
I'm good at a chase. I'll tell you another one. You stick me on that tipping point, I'm getting that star.
I mean, that's the easiest point.
I hate tipping point. I'm getting that star over.
It's ludicrously easy, though. The questions are a joke.
It's a penny falls machine, though, as well. So it's just.
No, you've got to answer the questions.
I know you need
son.
To answer the questions, so but it's ridiculous, the chase. You'd
Lane one,
in the
please.
Chase.
No, I'd like to see you on the 1%.
I'm brilliant at that. You know I'm good at that. You and I text each other.
He texts me on a Saturday night.
You know I'm good at the 1%.
Is that still going? I'd love to see you on that, actually.
Nah, I'm no good at
that. That's not a quiz show as such, but I'm not good at
Cube. No good at Cube. I'm good at the wall.
The Crystal Maze, remember that?
The wall. I think you'd be good on that.
Right.
You and Danny Dyer getting back and forward.
I don't want.
Oh, no, the original wall. Remember the original wall? Where what? You used to have to get in the shape when the wall was coming at you?
Or am I getting mixed up with something?
No,
see, before we cut off, right, I've got to get this out. The best, and I'm better than anybody.
I know what
you're
going to say here.
You know it.
Blank.
Naked attraction.
I am.
Very legs. By the way, see when the shutter went up, they seen his legs.
Yeah.
I can get him off.
Can I be called that? How many's there?
Stop it. Absolute child. Stop. 0141 951 1025.
Oh, is this not a football show?
Scott in Cambuslang is about to make it one. Scott, how do you look back on Sunday?
Never mind Sunday. I think there's too much hilarity on that show, by the way.
No, I'm sorry.
The Dazzler should be on Love Island or something.
Oh, don't.
No, listen, guys. I just wanted to obviously, the past couple of days, the Rangers fans have been coming on and moaning, right? But I think Big Scalesy should be getting a big pat in the back here, right? You know, going to Ibrox, getting the man of the match, you know, it's no easy feat. I think in the first half, you know, Celtic ran the first half, Rangers pummeled to, that's fine, you know, but I think the big difference is between the two of them. We've got an out-and-out striker who knows where the goal is. You know, Calmack was brilliant. As I say, Scalesy was brilliant. You know, Joe Hart pulled off a couple of fantastic saves. So I think, obviously, you know, I just wanted to come on and give Scalesy a big pat in the back, to be honest with you, you know, because that was a makeshift defence and the big man was brilliant. Absolutely amazing.
I totally agree. I don't think you'll find anybody out there, Scott, that wouldn't agree with that assessment, his performance. And quite difficult after minute one when, you know, you make that small error that led to the first chalked off goal. You know, quite hard to compose yourself after that, because he would have been well aware that even that movement was the wrong thing, but he settled well. And I was most impressed with him in possession as well, how calm he was. You know, and you need a calming influence at the back when you go to Ibrox and you come under pressure, but when you get possession, you've got to keep it and make the right passes. But the second half was particularly impressive when Celtic had to defend their own box time and time again, found themselves in the right positions. And he showed really that, you know, he can fill that role. And I've seen a lot of Celtic fans actually mention on social media as well that an option might be if Greg Taylor doesn't hit, you know, the form he did last season, and Bernabe, well, Dazzy's favourite Bernabe certainly doesn't look the answer. Can Scales go to left back? If you're looking to have a more solid unit, a more physical unit at the back, could Scales be an option there? So quite interesting how a week can shape your career. Because last week it was, this guy's not good enough and he's going out the door. Now people are talking about
I wasn't surprised. Sorry, Gordon. I wasn't surprised. I said it before we went into the studio on Saturday. We were talking about when the Celtic team came in. I said, I'm not concerned about Scales. And the reason being, I think he'd a lot going for him. He's been to Ibrox, he's played with Aberdeen, he's played in front of 50,000 at Ibrox. He knows the atmosphere, he knows what he's in for. Yes, it's a different ball going there with Celtic. Of course it is. You're under a lot more pressure, especially if you're a centre-back with Celtic and all the spotlight's on the defence. I was more concerned about Lagerby Elka, to be honest. Scales, first couple of minutes, everybody thought, oh, this could turn out nasty. He goes in, probably a little bit too eager, get caught up in the excitement, the adrenaline. But after that, his positional play was absolutely brilliant. The boy deserves all the pats in the back. I'm glad Scott, as a Celtic supporter, come on and recognised that, because he took a lot of criticism. Mm. And the minute the team comes out, Celtic supporters on social media, oh, I can't believe Scales, Rangers are... He showed everybody that he's a decent, decent player.
What do you think it means for him going forward, Scott? Because obviously, you know, Nat Phillips will be presumably fit very soon, and then not too far round the corner, Mike Navrotsky, Cameron Carter-Vickers. He's clearly shown he can be trusted on Sunday. I just wonder, what does that mean long term?
Well, I think Mark made a good point. Obviously, you know, Taylor isn't playing the heights he has done in the past couple of seasons. You know, I think Scalesy can go there, right? But, you know, I think you know, we've all seen the football loads of times. One game doesn't make you a hero, right? But at the end of the day, it's consistency. Do you know what I mean? And he has to get games just now. Obviously, he'll get games just now because the guys are injured. But I think Mark makes a good shout. If Taylor's no being the best that he can be, you know, Scales is an option to be there, you know, but you know, there's an option. You know, I don't think that it should be no looked at, if you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? Because, you know, as I said, man of the match at Ibrox, 50,000 fans down your throat. All right, he made a couple of wee bits in the first couple of minutes, but that just showed you the man he is. He got himself controlled, he got himself back up, and man of the match. As I say, you know, it's no, that's no an easy feat, especially at Ibrox. At any home away game, do you know what I mean? But especially at Ibrox. So I just think, you know, he should be walking proud with his head held high and be proud of himself, to be honest with you.
He has to make the most of the short time that he has, and that's the best he can do. Now, if he plays after the international break and he turns out the same performance, then it's very difficult to drop him if he's a standout.
Because straight away, without getting too far ahead, that I mean, I assume that Phillips, for one, will be available for that game.
Yeah.
So straight away, there's
the
a
next
decision
selection,
there.
Yeah, I'll tell a story where Brendan Rodgers backs who he had at Ibrox, those men that he spoke about after the game, or if Nat Phillips was bought to just go right in and play. Now, we all assumed that, well, I assumed anyway, that Nat Phillips would be bought for those big games like Sunday. But might not be the case. Brendan Rodgers might be loyal to Scales, but the one thing Scales has got to do is keep performing.
Okay, this will be the earliest we've ever picked a team for a game, I must say. But thank you very much to Scott on the line on 01419511025 and on Twitter as well, at ClydeSSB. It's a good time to call. We'll get you on next with a full-time teaser.
Taking your calls on Scottish football. 0141 951 1025. This is Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Mark Wilson and Gordon DL are here. It's 0141 951 1025. We're going to try the impossible, or I think the impossible's already underway. We're all fans of football teams in Scotland seem to be united on one issue today, and that is in resistance to these government proposals to change the rules around football supporters' buses. If you've heard about that and you want to get in touch, please do. And if not, we'll tell you what you need to know, because it's received quite a backlash. So we'll do that very soon. I appreciate people still want to talk about the weekend as well. So let's get this up and running quickly.
The full-time teaser with Sliding Wardrobe Solutions, East Kilbride. Score winning wardrobes at their new trade counter at Colville's Road.
Thank you to Ben Carson for emailing me fulltime at Clyde1.com with this question. Please keep your questions coming in. Very straightforward. Can you name the 9 Scots who've started an English Premier League game this season? Very simple.
Dominey.
Nope. Good start.
Gilmore.
He's not started.
Barely.
Okay, Christie.
On. Yep.
Armstrong. Armstrong started.
For who?
Oh, he's Southampton in the Championship. Take that one back. The lad, Hickey.
Okay, we'll leave it there then. No more at the moment. We'll see if we can get online before the end of the show. Fulltime at Clyde1.com. Fulltime at Clyde1.com. Let's bring in Scott, who's in Auchinlock. Hi, Scott.
Hi, how are you, panel? Good evening.
How are you? You all right?
I'm very well, thanks. Just been listening to the phone in the last couple of nights, and I think there's been a right overreaction over the defeat on Sunday, and here's why. A week before the Old Firm game, you had the Celtic fans on going about Brendan Rodgers coming back, wasn't the right man, right? So if Celtic had been beat on Sunday, then this whole week there'd been Celtic fans on, but they didn't get beat, and it's Rangers fans. The other thing as well, being as all I've heard is about the new players, no good enough. What about the responsibility of the players that were fed there? The tried and tested, so to speak, that have been there, especially with our back line. You count the back four, you count Raskin. There's not one player in the Rangers team that's playing very well. And I think it's unfair that the new players are getting it in the neck, where I think it's the experienced players that should be getting it in the neck, especially the back four. And I count the likes of Goldson, Suter, Tavernier, who consistently make mistake after mistake that leads to goals. And that's my point.
Is that fair? Maybe more focus on the tried and tested?
I kind of disagree again with what Scott's saying. You know, the focus is always on new players coming in, because fans just expect a reaction. Fans expect new signings to take you to a different level. But one thing is got to remain consistent or get better as well under a manager or a coach is the players that are already at the club. And I've seen this all week. You know, a lot of Rangers fans having a go at the back line, because there has been a couple of constants in that. I think if Barisic was fit, he would have played at the weekend as well. So you would have had Barisic, Goldson and Tavernier, who served the club over a number of years. And, you know, there's fans are seeing the same mistakes time and time again. Like, there's no doubt, if you isolate him, I think Connor Goldson's a good defender. I think he's a good centre-half. I think James Tavernier is an excellent attacking right back. And Barisic in the final third can prove his worth. But defensively, together, there are issues there that have followed them throughout the years as well. There's big mistakes, and I think the Rangers fans are realising that now. And what if there was a change? Would it be better? Of course, you take Tavernier out of the team, you lose his goals, you lose his assists, which is a massive part of Rangers, and it's quite unusual. You get that through somewhere. You take Barisic, well, you lose the delivery. Do you put in somebody more sturdy at the back, more reliable, more defensive-minded? Do you get a better result? Well, then you depend on the guys further up. So it has a knock-on effect in your team, and Michael Beale has to have those players further up the pitch to allow him to do that at the back.
Well, that's the Scott. A lot of the criticism then has been also aimed at the manager for signing the new players. If you want to focus on the guys that have been there before, does that mean the manager is not as culpable for you as he is for other people?
Well, the players were basically in before Beale took over the first appointment as being manager. But the very focus about what I'm talking about the team in general is the reality is we talk about not having an identity, a style of play. We don't have the back four. It needs to start from the back four from the keeper to have a style of play, because who wants to see long ball football? But we don't have the defenders to play that. Unless we're playing the lesser clubs, we can put pressure on them. They're so to speak, sitting back, and they can throw about. See, as soon as we come up, a half-decent team, as soon as we come up against Celtic, Aberdeen, Hearts, possibly Hibs, we can't play that football. And especially in Europe, we talk about, now, we're not even in the UEFA, the games of the UEFA Cup yet. I'm really worried about them, because I don't even see us getting in that group at all. So it's going to get worse. But I still don't think that, as much as I'm not a great Beale fan, we can't be shouting about bringing a new manager in. You've got to give him the season, and absolute fact is, if he doesn't win the league, they will get sacked anyway. But you've got to let that happen. You can't sack him now.
So end of the season regardless?
Well, probably Christmas. If we're 68 points behind Celtic for Christmas, he'll probably get sacked, yeah, unless he's neck and neck.
Merry Christmas. Thank you very much to Scott in Auchinlock on 01419511025. I know a lot wants to be still said about the weekend's games. I understand that. But there's a big story today that I want to turn attentions to, if you don't mind, because there's been an incredible backlash on social media to government proposals to basically change the rules around football supporters' buses. Now, that's a hugely important part of the fan experience, isn't it, for so many of us? I think we all know that Scottish football per capita is incredibly well supported. So many of us will have been on supporters' buses in the past. And some quite alarming proposals have come out talking about, you know, vehicles not being able to stop within 10 miles of the venue. Basically, alcohol only allowed to be sold with a substantial meal. I mean, some of it reads like as if it's a bit of a joke, to be quite honest. Talking about these buses leaving within 30 minutes of the game finishing, just all sorts of real restrictions that it would place on the football fan here. So what I wanted to do was bring in Derek Watson, who joins us on the line, because in a sort of weird way, Derek, you seem to have discovered this, if that's the right phrase. You put out a tweet last night talking about this, and it has been picked up at a spectacular pace today. So just kind of talk us through your part in this.
Hi Gordon, thanks for having us on. Yeah, as you mentioned, you know, I put a tweet out about this last night. This is something that was published on the UK government website last week, so it's been sitting there for a while, and I was made aware of it, and I thought, you know, why is nobody talking about this? This seems totally draconian, over the top, restrictive of fans' movement on a match day. So I put out a tweet, didn't really expect too much to come off it. And it seems to have united football fans all across the country. You know, there's not many things that brings people from both sides of the divide in Glasgow together, but it seems that everybody as opposed to this. I want to say that I was shocked when I noticed it, but to be honest, I wasn't. You know, as a football fan, this is something that you just have become subjected to and used to over the years in Scotland. Well, following your team, I'm sure many will sympathise with that view. So I suppose, yeah, I was disappointed and angry, but that's nothing new, and it's something that I believe collectively, you know, as football fans, we're going to have to deal with together.
Yeah, I mean, for anyone, I'll recap quickly, for anyone who hasn't seen this, these plans are talking about bus companies must tell a dedicated football officer 48 hours before the game the number of fans in the bus, the number of buses booked, names and contact details. The buses can't stop anywhere within 10 miles of a ground without police permission. Buses can't stop at any pub for a beer unless it's sold with a substantial meal. And that's why you've seen all the in-betweeners clips of Will ordering a, whatever it is, a Sunday roast or whatever, hot pot, I can't remember the line. Buses can't drop off or pick up fans at any unauthorised locations without prior permission of the police. Arrive at the venue no earlier than 2 hours before and not later than 1 hour before the start of the game. Is that, I mean, not only, you said draconian, Derek, not only sort of unfair, but surely completely unworkable as well.
Yeah, I mean, this isn't going to work. You know, I can't imagine that Police Scotland will be happy about this either. You know, it makes their job very difficult. And, you know, the one thing that you mentioned there is that you can't arrive within certain times. You know, you can't be within 10 miles of the stadium without permission by the police. I can only speak as a Motherwell fan. You know, we're a fan-owned football club, and the fans are the life and soul of everything that we do at Fir Park. But if you look at many small businesses as well, the knock-on effect for pubs and restaurants around football stadiums is going to be catastrophic. The one that always springs out to me that I'm sure many listeners will be familiar with is the Mallard in Dingwall, which is a wee pub restaurant that sits on the platform at the train station 100 yards from the Ross County Football Stadium. That solely survives on the trade from away football supporters. You know, if away fans can't go within 10 miles of the stadium, they're not allowed to go in that pub to have a drink without ordering, I think you were going to say, a Carvery meal or something along those lines in between those winners. If they can't do that, these businesses aren't going to survive. So yes, there is the restrictive draconian measures that you're seeing on football fans, but there's also a big knock-on effect for local businesses, publicans and restaurants, which I think is a real worry as well. You know, this just hasn't, it's not been thought through, it's unworkable, it's unmanageable, and it's totally over the top.
Is this already in place in England, in Wales, and they're trying now to bring it to Scotland? Is it enforced down there? What's the lay of the land?
That's an interesting point, and I think that's something that, you know, Scottish football need to dig a bit deeper into. In the consultation document, which people will see if they go onto the UK government website, it says that this is in place in England and Wales already, which is, you know, up for debate. The laws are in place, but it doesn't happen every week. So what they have down there, and I'm sure Rangers fans might be aware of this, they have bubble matches. So if they deem a match to be high risk, they will take supporters to somewhere at the side of a motorway where they collect their tickets at a service station. They'll hold them at a specific pub, maybe 10 miles, for example, outside of a city centre or a town where they can have a drink. And then within an hour and a half before the match, they'll bust them into the stadium. One thing that I would say goes in favour of English clubs down there is obviously they do not have alcohol bans in their stadiums. So the clubs aren't going to come out in England and say that they think this is a disgrace if they're going to have 10,000 away fans in the stadium an hour before the game buying 2-3 pints each. You know, they're going to make a fortune out of this. So in Scotland, football clubs are penalised for that as well. So that's another thing to add to the list of football fans. You know, they're not allowed to drink, they're not allowed to do X, Y and Z. So it is in place sometimes in England, but it's not every week. I noticed a few English football fans actually replying to my post on Twitter and saying, you know, we've had this in place for a number of years now. There's been times where a bus has been pulled at the side of the motorway, two guys up the back of the bus have been caught drinking beer, every single person has been taken off the bus by the police, issued with a Section 60 warning and sent back to the town that they came from. You know, they're allowed to go to the game. So it's going to affect people of all walks of life. You know, they say that they're bringing this in to tackle football fans and the rise in hooliganism and whatever other things they want to say. But what they need to remember is the majority of people that are going on these buses are families. You know, they're people of all ages, all genders. It's not just young guys boozed up and looking to cause a bit of bother.
You know, we kind of joked about nothing unites football fans really, but you know, this seems to have, how important is it that football fans do sort of start getting a bit more respect or appreciation for also the good that can be done as well, rather than just focusing on negatives all the time, and try and resist this notion that, you know, football fans are this like one homogenous group that you can sort of, you know, you can tar with a certain brush.
Absolutely. I mean, I touched on it earlier. We rely so heavily, you know, on our communities to be the lifeblood of football clubs. You know, we're asking people to pay a lot of money to go and watch football teams in the middle of a cost of living crisis. And laws and measures like this being put in place can be a real danger to that, and can be a real danger to the future of football clubs, especially clubs like Motherwell, St Mirren, you know, smaller clubs out with Rangers and Celtic who really, really rely on the gate income. I genuinely struggle to see any other section of society where people are constantly demonised and belittled the way that football fans are. So for me, you know, there is a classist argument to it, but I think it's important that all football fans come together on this. It's been really positive to see that so far. It just shows the strength of feeling there is towards this issue. Hopefully we can get some sort of, what I would like to see, some sort of fan-led campaign, you know, take away the colours and the scarves and let's get together and say this really can't happen in Scotland, we're better than that.
Yeah, I noticed, well, obviously the SFA put out a statement on behalf of them, the SPFL, SWPL, I think Motherwell were perhaps the first club that did similar. A minute ago, Morton have done the same, sharing the concerns, and this will be picking up pace. Right now, what can fans do? Because is this still at consultation stage? Fans can give their feedback, you know, because we always sort of try and bang the drum for football fans on here. So what can we all do to try and have the appropriate say?
It's still at the consultation stage at the moment. The consultation was issued on the 30th of August, so just last week. That will run right up until the 24th of November. They're looking to hear from individuals, you know, supporters groups, people who run buses, any sort of organisation, just to make it clear what your views are on this proposal. You can email an email address, which is, I'm sure you can tweet it out afterwards. It's like TCCO consultations at some sort of government website. The person in post that's dealing with this consultation is called Mark Richardson, and he's a Traffic Commission corporate office. So even if you could go Mark Richardson at the UK government or so, you'll be able to find his details. But I would encourage anyone that's concerned about this to, you know, get in touch with that email address. Or even if you're old school like Hugh Keevans or so, send a letter by post, because this is something that's going to affect everyone. You know, it's really concerning, and I hope that football fans can come together and make a difference.
There you are, Shaw. Get your ink pot out and get a letter written. Thank you very much to Derek, who clearly feels very passionately about these things, but I'm sure lots of you do as well. And like we said, we always think we can at least try and stick up for football fans on this show. So if you want any further information, I'll try and stick something out on social media. Because it's quite alarming to read, Mark.
Oh, without doubt. I mean, I was shocked when I read it, and the fact that it's been sitting there for quite a while, like Derek was saying there, is even more alarming. And football fans always seem to get the raw deal of things. Derek highlighting the good that the football community does for all sorts of businesses, and they always seem to get marginalised or punished. And this is just a different way. You'd like to know why. Derek touched on it there maybe, but tackling hooliganism and cutting down and violence at the games, but that is the minority. You think of the majority who travel in supporters buses all around the country and make a day of it with their family and their friends, who are now going to be, you know, have their whole experience changed. Incredible. So the more people that highlight this and support or go against it, the better. And the sooner that happens, then it'll make for a better match day experience for everybody.
And there we are. Right, full disclosure, just very quickly, right? Because I know Derek well, right? Derek's a friend of mine, which is neither here nor there, because he's off doing this thing, and he's by the looks of Twitter, he's a bigger Twitter star now. Apparently, millions of people view his tweets. He's not even answering my calls. Had to get the producer to phone him. But I feel like it's a good opportunity to tell a good story.
Oh, right.
Do you know where this is going?
Yeah, I know where. I know exactly. Okay,
he'll be nervous from. In case it's about him. But
No.
There are a few of them.
About him.
So you might remember this, Mark Wilson. So that same caller was getting married, right, a couple of years ago. So he came on Beat the Pundit, and I tried to stitch him up. I tried to stitch him up on Beat the Pundit.
Because you were going to show it at his
wedding. And I was going to show it at the wedding. And so I gave Gordon Dale the answers. So he came on thinking he was the big man. He was going to win Beat the Pundit. So I thought, I'll give Gordon Dale the answers. Gordon will wipe the floor with him. And then I'll reveal it was all a big stitched up. So I gave Gordon the answers.
I went to tiebreaker.
And he still lost on the tiebreaker. He said I took them away too quickly.
In my defence, I didn't have time to study them. Went to a tiebreaker.
You're some man. Anyway,
unlucky.
You don't retain information.
Try and redeem yourself. Can you name 9 Scots who've started an English Premier League game this season? Ryan Christie, Billy Gilmore, who, how good was he at the weekend? Yeah.
Well, I give you 2. Mark will give you 2.
Just go on then.
Okay, I'll give you McKenna at Nottingham Forest.
Uh-huh.
And I'll give you Patterson at Everton.
Yep, Mark.
McGinn.
Yep.
Andy Robertson.
Okay, 2 to get, and we will get them next.
Number 1 for football in Glasgow and the West. 0141 951 1025. Clyde 1 Super Scoreboard.
Right, onto the final part. Still lots more to cram in though. It's so, so busy this start to the week. On the teaser quickly, 9 Scots who've started an English Premier League game this season. You've given me Christie, Gilmore, Hickey, McGinn, McKenna, Patterson and Robertson.
Shea Adams? No. Has he moved?
No.
No.
We've got the Newcastle one. I thought it was Gallagher. Is it Anderson? Yeah.
No.
How not?
He's not started a game. And also this is where we get ourselves in twists here, right? Because we always usually say, like, you're a Scot by football definition. So he's pulled out the Scotland squad tonight. And he has represented Scotland and England at youth level, and he was born in England. So I can't. My head's just spinning with it. Luckily, I don't think he's started. Either way, he's not on your list. That's what you need to know.
Right, we're under a bit of pressure here.
Where is Gunn?
Norwich.
That's a bowl for us.
Well, listen, you've got time. You've got 2 to get. We're going to speak to Scott, who's a Motherwell fan, in just a second. Let me quickly remind you of this, though, because this Thursday, how are you feeling, you two?
I'm feeling a wee bit nervous.
Oh, the ab sale.
The three of us. The three of us are ab sailing at Silverburn in aid of Cash for Kids on Thursday. Yeah. If you'd like to sponsor us, the details are on our socials. You can head to Clyde1.com/cashforkids. You can help raise money, make a real difference to children across Glasgow and the West. There is a serious point to this. It's not just laughing at these two in a harness. But I mean, by all means, if you're at a loose end on Thursday, why not come down, lend your support? Yeah, they'd be delighted to see you.
I've not picked out my outfit yet. I don't know what I'm going to wear.
Something
maybe go with a Spider-Man one.
Yeah, something tight.
Yeah
I think your fans would like that.
It's funny the things you do for charity to raise money.
Tell me about it.
We always seem to be the ones that get picked.
I have now done every form of falling from the sky for this charity. But it's worth it. It's for the kids.
It's for the kids.
Are we just expected to turn up and
jump off a building?
I'm sure they'll tell us.
There's been very little information.
I'm a bit concerned if we're going down Marks and Spencer's end or the other end.
I'll tell you what, if the weather's lengthened today, your fans will get some view of your rear end coming down.
No, they'll get some view.
They'll need some thick ropes for you. Double rope him.
Get that cran really good.
You might just put it around your waist.
Few bricks under that cran. Right, okay. He was only kidding on when you lost a bit of weight.
Anyway,
3 stone light on the
Clyde1.com /cashforkids. Help us raise money and come down and support these two. There we go. Scott is a Motherwell fan on the line. What's your point, Scott?
Good evening, panel. Thanks for taking my call. I was through at Tynecastle on Sunday. Delighted with the performance. I phoned up last season. It was a wee bit more negative with how things were panning out last season, but I think Stuart Kettlewell's drilled the team well. We're doing simple things better. The defensive frailties that we've been accustomed to at Fir Park and elsewhere seem to have kind of been ironed out. Bevis McGarvey had an outstanding performance in the heart of the defence. Dan Casey, superb again. And I think a big mention has to go to young Lennon Miller. In the middle of the park, he's strolling about like he's a 28-year-old seasoned pro. He's a very mature young lad, does the simple things very, very well. And I think we took the game 2 hearts on Sunday and reaped the rewards.
Yeah, Gordon, it's been, you always kind of look at this first international break, and I know it's very early, but it's still your first little kind of chapter of the season. It could barely have gone better for Motherwell. Obviously, disappointment going out the cup, but what a brilliant points return already.
Yeah, no surprise to me they went to Tynecastle and won Gordon. Where I think the big difference is, and I think it's just down to confidence now, you look at Motherwell's goal on Sunday. It was sensational.
Oh, brilliant, wasn't it?
Absolutely sensational. I think Scott makes good points. You know, the manager's throwing youth in there. Young Miller has been terrific. He had to replace Van Veen, and we thought that would have been a massive loss. But everybody's stepping up to the mark. He's got a nice balance to his team. I like McGabby. I know that I've been to Fir Park a few times and sitting, and he comes in sometimes a little bit of criticism. I think it's a bit unfair. I think he goes out there and does a very, very good job. They're just getting better and better, and they're playing with a lot of confidence. Midley Park's excellent as well. Good footballers in there. Slattery, I think, you know, I watch him sometimes. Terrific footballer. Good footballing brain as well. Mm. Good goal, composed. They deserve to be where they are because they're playing that brand of football. They're playing nice football.
People always say, Mark, you know, don't hype up young players too much and, you know, just relax. And that's valid, but it's also difficult. I think last Monday, Charlie Mulgrew, I asked the guys at the start, who was your man of the weekend or your top performer? Mm. He said, Lennon Miller. You know, bro. Yeah. I asked Andy Halliday yesterday. He said, Lennon Miller. And Scott's on already. You can also only really see what you're seeing.
You need to call it out, Gordon. When players are playing poorly, we're quick enough to call it out. Or if young players go in, we're quick enough to say, oh, they're not quite ready and the manager's at fault. So you need to call it out the other way. And Lennon Miller's been absolutely terrific since he's pulled on a Motherwell shirt this season. He's really, like Scott says, he looks like a man in there, which is, you know, quite unusual for one so young to go in there and just adapt to the league so quickly. Mm. And I've said before, he's got a great grounding behind him, great family behind him who have been there and done it before. I think that also helps as well. But he's got a manager that trusts youth and plays youth. But the player has to give it back when he gets on the pitch, and he's certainly doing that.
How good a manager do you think Stuart Kettlewell is or and can be, Scott?
I think he's you know, even when he first came in, Gordon, he talked well. And we've done a wee bit of background on him, you know, to see how things had panned out previously in his career, to see what we're getting. And he talked openly about travelling Europe and looking at other coaches and different techniques. But I think a lot also has to be said about the man management that he has, because he seems to have galvanised the players. And when, you know, the final whistle went on Sunday, the fans all stayed behind, and the players all came across, and you know, it was a great atmosphere, and you could sense that thrill on the players, and Stuart Kettlewell as well. You know, he's punching there, and that feeds on to the players, and that'll probably affect the players that are injured. They'll look to try and bounce back as quickly as they can to be part of this journey. To you know, move Motherwell as far up the league and away from that Bolton 6 they were last year, and that has to be ultimately our target for the season. It's got to be that top 6. Anything better than the top 6, you know, if we can get in amongst the Hibs and Hearts, and we've shown at Fir Park against Hibs and now at Tynecastle where Motherwell can be. But you know, like I said to the producer earlier, let's not get carried away. Let's keep things in perspective that, you know, we're a young team with guys like Lennon Miller. We've got a young manager, you know. So I think Stuart Kettlewell, as long as we can keep him and he's not got any other clubs that are coming sniffing about him, then I am. The future's bright.
Good man, Scott. We're going to have to nip it there. As you can hear, the music's on. The pressure is on us here. Right, quickly, two more Scots that have started an English Premier League game.
Struggling here.
Sheffield United striker. You forgot about him, didn't you? Right up.
Still forgot him.
McBurney.
McBurney.
Mm-hmm. And
still there.
This is a real tough one, because I must admit I had lost track of this. I can't even remember. Oh no, yeah, he's Fulham. Oh, he's always been Fulham recently. Midfield player.
Just
doesn't play for the national team much anymore.
Yeah.
Hurry up.
Kearney.
No. Tom Kearney.
Aye.
Right, brilliant. Thank you to the guys. Don't forget, make sure you head over to Clyde1.com because we're giving you the chance to win a 70-inch telly there thanks to Moir and Sweeney Litigation. They're supporting us this week, and Andrew McLean will be in Cyprus. Big week for the national team. More to come on the phones tomorrow from 6, so make sure you join us tomorrow.